Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Wired That Way, a comprehensive guide to understanding and maximizing your personality type, by Marita Littauer, with insights by Florence Littauer. Narrated by Janet Metzger. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Wired That Way into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the supplemental contents section, please enter the access code NEED, and then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All charts, tables, checklists, figures, and appendices referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Chapter 1: Foundation and Background. Have you ever noticed that there are people out there who are different from you? Perhaps you live with them. Maybe you work with them. But chances are that you have noticed differences and you have wished that you could change those people. You may have even gone so far as to try to fix them by suggesting that their way of thinking, attitude, and approach to life should be more like your own. But these attempts usually end in futility and frustration. Those people's differences just seem to be hardwired into their personality. As you think about those people whom you may have tried to change, and as you reflect on your own personal growth, I want you to consider Romans chapter 12, verse 18. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with everyone. I love how this verse is presented in three parts. The first part says, "If it is possible." It is as if God is giving us a disclaimer, as if He is saying that this is a goal we should try to reach. The second part says, so far as it depends on you, making this our individual responsibility to, the last part, be at peace with everyone. If this verse simply said, be at peace with everyone, it would be impossible for us to live out this teaching. We all have had situations with people in which we have tried everything we know how to do to get along with them, but nothing seems to work. No matter how hard we try, we cannot change those individuals. However, as this verse in Romans suggests, we can change ourselves. We can grow and improve. We can also change our approach to others so that we can, so far as it depends on us, be at peace with everyone. Once we give up trying to change the people in our life and accept that they are just wired that way, we can begin to understand others and improve our relationships with them. Likewise, when we are able to grasp the way we are wired, we can use that knowledge to grow beyond our natural tendencies and become better and more balanced individuals. Personality, learned or inherited. While each person is wired differently, there are many similarities that allow people to be grouped into general categories. The study of these differences and their interrelationship is known as the personalities. A recent article in Life magazine stated that studies of twins and advances in molecular biology have uncovered a more significant genetic component to personality than was previously known. Researchers have spent countless hours and dollars on studies in order to determine where our personalities come from. These researchers are now beginning to grasp what any parent or teacher will tell you. We all come with our own personality, determined before birth within our individual genetic makeup. Environment plays a role in how that personality is shaped, but the basics are predetermined. I once met with a group of preschool directors and asked them if they had ever had several siblings go through their schools. Of course, the answer was yes. I then asked them to consider the fact that each of these children had the same parents, grew up in the same house, and went to the same church or preschool. Often they wore the same clothes and slept in the same room as their siblings. But were they just like each other? The answer was a resounding no. Despite having virtually the same environment, these siblings each had their own distinct personality. Some were incessant talkers who liked to be the focal point and whom others wanted to emulate. Others were born leaders and liked to tell the other little children what to do and when to do it. These children would take over the class if the teacher let them. Others were more reserved and quiet, afraid to get messy, and avoided projects like finger painting in favor of tidy, methodical activities like building blocks or reading. Other quiet children were content with any activity and easily went along with the program, rarely initiating any ideas of their own. These same patterns follow us throughout our lives. They are inborn personality traits, the way we are wired. It's all Greek to me. The study of inborn personality traits is not a new science. During the Golden Age of Greece, around 400 BC, renowned Greek thinkers studied and philosophized about life and the universe. One of the areas that especially aroused their curiosity was the study of the differing natures of people. Just like the group of preschool directors that I met with, and probably just like you, they noticed that people are different. One particular Greek thinker, Hippocrates, known today as the father of modern medicine, theorized that what made people so different was their body chemistry. Only recently have we come to learn that he may have been right on more counts than he has been given credit for. He and other Greek thinkers believed that people could be categorized into four basic groupings and that their differing physical makeup, or fluids in their bodies, was what gave them the specific outward manifestations, what identified their personality. Around AD 190, Galen, a Greek physician, built on Hippocrates' ideas and came up with what he called the four temperaments, four personality types or moods that he said were caused by the imbalance of certain bodily fluids in people. He called these four temperaments sanguine, choleric, melancholy, and phlegmatic. Over the years, people have added to and expounded upon these concepts, often giving them different names so as to appear more clever or original. And today, there are a variety of different teachings available on this general topic. For example, some of these new systems will refer to the sanguine as emotional, influencing, socializer, or expressive. The choleric as volitional, dominant, director, or driving. The melancholy as rational, cautious, thinker, or analytical. And the phlegmatic as personal, steady, relator, or amiable. However, regardless of the terms used, these basically all come back to these same four personality types that were originally determined thousands of years ago. So, if you are familiar with one of these other systems, understand that we are all talking the same language, just using slightly different terms to mean the same thing. You'll just need to translate as we go along. Most people who are familiar with these other approaches find that this personality program focuses more on the positives rather than the pathology, and is more helpful in solving relationship problems. While many personality typing programs give you a label, they do not tell you what to do with that information. The goal of this program, however, is to move you beyond the label and into application, so that you can see real changes in your relationships. As you listen, I trust that you will have fun discovering who you are, and that you will be able to quickly apply the principles to grow beyond your natural personality while improving all your relationships, both at home and at work. Grandma Knows, Ruth Crow, Certified Personality Trainer. Every grandmother knows what a joy their grandchildren are. I had the opportunity to take my granddaughter Morgan to her first day of kindergarten. From my experience, I know this can be a terrifying and traumatic experience for some children. Morgan and I entered the room that morning and looked around. Some of the children were crying, some were clinging to their parents, and some were sucking their thumbs. Not Morgan. No, not Morgan. She took a few moments to size up the situation and then began telling the other children what to do, where to sit, who to talk to, what toy to play with, and what book to look at. Morgan was 5 years old, a little girl, and the youngest in her family. No one had taught her how to be bossy or how to be a leader. Watching Morgan's first day of school illustrated to me that personalities transcend age, gender, birth order, environment, or learned behavior. Basic personality groupings. Let's start by looking at the basic personality groupings, realizing that any time we take the entire population of the world and put all those people into one of four categories, we will be making generalizations. No one person will fit exactly into one box. But the thing about generalizations is that they are generally true. While we are all unique individuals, most of us do have our own set of colored glasses through which we view life and from which our decisions are made. This makes up our basic personality. In addition to our basic personality, everyone has a secondary personality and usually has a smattering of traits from some of the other categories. We will review the various combinations in Chapter 4. The chart in the bonus PDF will give you an at-a-glance review of the personalities. I'll describe the characteristics of each personality and provide a quick overview of each personality. You will want to refer to these overviews from time to time as you familiarize yourself with the personalities. The popular sanguine. People with sanguine personalities are typically high-energy people who are fun-loving and outgoing. These are the people who are always looking for the next gathering or get-together with their friends. Originally, the ancient Greeks believed that people with this personality type behaved this way because they had red-hot blood coursing through their veins, hence the name sanguine, which relates to the blood. Today, the word sanguine is also used to describe someone who is optimistic or confident. Because the word sanguine isn't commonly used in speech today, throughout this book it will be coupled with the word popular when it is being used to represent a personality type. Of course, if you are familiar with this teaching from another source and are accustomed to just the word sanguine, feel free to use it. Or simply use the term popular if you find sanguine cumbersome. Remember, it's not about labels or how we refer to the personality types. It's about understanding ourselves and also improving our relationships. The powerful choleric. People with choleric personalities are naturally goal-oriented and live to achieve those goals. They are highly task-oriented and well-organized, but they are also outgoing, just like the popular sanguines. However, in addition to having these positive traits, cholerics also tend to have a short fuse and to be bossy. Hippocrates and the Greek thinkers believed that people who displayed this type of personality had yellow bile in their bodies that gave them these specific traits, like a baby with colic or a person with cholera, hence the name choleric. Choleric is pronounced like collar on a shirt, not like calorie. For the same reasons as sanguine before, throughout this book, the term choleric will be coupled with the word powerful to better define this strong personality type, the powerful choleric. Popular sanguines. Let's do it the fun way. Representative color, yellow, like a happy face. Desire, to have fun. Key strengths, ability to talk about anything at any time, at any place. Bubbling personality, optimism, sense of humor, storytelling ability, enjoyment of people. Key weaknesses. Disorganized, can't remember details or names, exaggerates, not serious about anything, trusts others to do the work, too gullible and naive. Emotional needs, attention, affection, approval, acceptance. Get depressed when life is no fun and no one seems to love them. Are afraid of being unpopular or bored, having to live by the clock, having to keep a record of money spent. Like people who listen and laugh, praise and approve. Dislike people who criticize, don't respond to their humor, don't think they are cute. Are valuable at work for their colorful creativity, optimism, light touch, cheering up others, entertaining. Could improve if they got organized, didn't talk so much, learned to tell time. As leaders, excite, persuade, and inspire others, exude charm and entertain, are forgetful and poor on follow-through. Tend to marry perfect melancholies who are sensitive and serious, but whom they quickly tire of having to cheer up, and by whom they soon tire of being made to feel inadequate or stupid. React to stress by leaving the scene, going shopping, finding a fun group, creating excuses, blaming others. Recognized by their constant talking, loud volume, bright eyes. Powerful colorics. Let's do it my way. Representative color, red, like a fire engine. Desire, to have control. Key strengths, ability to take charge of anything instantly and to make quick, correct judgments. Key weaknesses, too bossy, domineering, autocratic, insensitive, impatient, unwilling to delegate or give credit to others. Emotional needs, sense of obedience, appreciation for accomplishments, credit for ability. Get depressed when life is out of control and people won't do things their way. Are afraid of losing control of anything, for example, losing a job, not being promoted, becoming seriously ill, having a rebellious child or unsupportive mate. Like people who are supportive and submissive, see things their way, cooperate quickly, let them take credit. Dislike people who are lazy and not interested in working constantly, buck their authority, become independent, aren't loyal. Are valuable at work because they can accomplish more than anyone else in a shorter time, are usually right. Could improve if they allowed others to make decisions, delegated authority, became more patient, didn't expect everyone to produce as they do. As leaders, they have a natural feel for being in charge, a quick sense of what will work, a sincere belief in their ability to achieve, a potential to overwhelm less aggressive people. Tend to marry peaceful phlegmatics who will quietly obey and not buck their authority, but who never accomplish enough or get excited over their projects. React to stress by tightening control, working harder, exercising more, getting rid of the offender. Recognized by their fast-moving approach, quick grab for control, self-confidence, restless and overpowering attitude. The perfect melancholy. People with melancholy personalities tend to be quiet, deep, and thoughtful. They strive for perfection in everything they do that matters to them, and believe that if a job is worth doing, it's worth doing right. Because people with this personality type focus so much on perfection, they often find themselves more disappointed and even more depressed than the other personalities. The Greek thinkers believed that people who displayed this type of personality behaved this way because of the black bile in their body, thus the name melancholy. Today, this word is often used to describe people who are depressed or have negative mood swings. To focus on the positive aspects of this personality, throughout this book, the term perfect will be coupled with melancholy to describe this personality type. The peaceful phlegmatic. People with the final personality type, the phlegmatics, are a bit harder to identify than the other personalities. While the popular sanguines, powerful cholerics, and perfect melancholies tend to live life to the extreme, individuals with phlegmatic personalities tend to be more balanced and contented with life. As such, they often do not feel the need to change the world or alter the existing status quo. People who display this type of personality are often viewed by the more driven personality types as being slower and more thoughtful, which may be why Hippocrates and the other early Greek philosophers believed that people who displayed this type of personality had phlegm in their bodies, thus the name phlegmatic. Because this word is often foreign to most of us, throughout this book, the term peaceful will be coupled with phlegmatic to better describe these balanced, steady, and easygoing individuals. Remember, these terms are listed here in order to provide us with some form of shared vocabulary so that we can better discuss each of our personalities. The goal here is not to label anyone or put them in a box, but just to give some general characteristics that are common among people who share these different personality types. Perfect melancholies. Let's do it the right way. Representative color, blue, like deep water. Desire to have it done right. Key strengths. Ability to organize and set long-range goals, to set high standards and ideals, and to analyze deeply. Key weaknesses: easily depressed, spends too much time on preparation, is too focused on details, remembers negatives, suspicious of others. Emotional needs: sense of stability, space, silence, sensitivity, support. Get depressed when life is out of order, standards aren't met, no one seems to care. Are afraid of no one understanding how they really feel, making a mistake, having to compromise standards. Like people who are serious, intellectual, deep, and can carry on a sensible conversation. Dislike people who are lightweights, forgetful, late, disorganized, superficial, prevaricating, and unpredictable. Are valuable at work for their sense of detail, love of analysis, follow-through, high standards of performance, compassion for the hurting. Could improve if they didn't take life quite so seriously, didn't insist that others be perfectionists. As leaders, they organize well, are sensitive to people's feelings, have deep creativity, want quality performance. Tend to marry popular sanguines because of their outgoing personality and social skills, but whom they soon attempt to quiet and get on a schedule. react to stress by withdrawing, getting lost in a book, becoming depressed, giving up, recounting problems. Recognized by their serious and sensitive nature, well-mannered approach, self-deprecating comments, meticulous and well-groomed looks. Peaceful phlegmatics. Let's do it the easy way. Representative color, green, like the grass. Desire to avoid conflict, to keep peace. Key strengths, balance, even disposition, dry sense of humor, pleasing personality. Key weaknesses, lack of decisiveness, enthusiasm or energy, a hidden will of iron. Emotional needs, sense of respect, feeling of worth, understanding, emotional support. Get depressed when life is filled with conflict, they have to face a personal confrontation, no one wants to help, or when the buck stops with them. Are afraid of having to deal with major personal problems, being left holding the bag, making major changes. Like people who make decisions for them, recognize their strengths, do not ignore them, and give them respect. Dislike people who are too pushy, too loud, or expect too much of them. Are valuable at work because they mediate between contentious people and objectively solve problems. Could improve if they set goals and became self-motivated, were willing to do more and move faster than expected, face their own problems as well as they handle those of others. As leaders, they keep calm, cool, and collected, don't make impulsive decisions, are well-liked and inoffensive, don't cause trouble, don't often come up with brilliant new ideas. Tend to marry powerful cholerics who are strong and decisive, but whom they soon tire of because they realize that they don't like being pushed around and looked down upon. React to stress by hiding from it, watching TV, eating, tuning out life. Recognized by their calm approach, relaxed posture, sitting or leaning when possible. In the next few chapters, we will go into more detail regarding each of the personalities. However, before proceeding, I recommend that you complete the Wired That Way personality profile located in the bonus PDF so that you can determine which personality type best fits you. By completing the personality profile, you will be able to apply the discussions in later chapters to your own life and also to those with whom you interact every day. You are here, Catherine Robbins. Completing the personality profile may seem like taking a test, but it's a tool that will help you find a starting point. Think of it as going to the shopping mall. First, you need to decide to go to the mall. You need something. You park your car and walk in. Do the profile. Now, if you don't know exactly where you are, you might wander around in circles. So, a helpful thing to do is to look for the directory board and find the "You Are Here" sticker. Add up your totals. Once you figure out where "You Are Here" is, you can then make a personality plan for getting from where you are to where you want to be. You may find you're on the wrong end of the mall, living in weaknesses, which means it will take a little more time to get where you want to go, living in strengths. The journey may be long or short, but at least you're not aimlessly walking around in circles anymore. While most people live with a mix of their personality strengths and weaknesses, what you want to become is a well-balanced individual who is living in his or her strengths, not wallowing in weaknesses. This book is your personality plan. While you are wired a certain way, you can use the tools and techniques in this book to overcome natural tendencies that hinder you from making the connections in your wiring that turn the lights on. Yes, you are here. But here is not where you will want to stay. Apply the personality plan and enjoy living in your strengths. Chapter 2. Visible Clues. Now that you know your personality, you are probably wondering about which basic personalities fit your friends, family members, and co-workers. If you all get along, you can pass out individual personality profiles and have them all take one, like a game. In fact, in my office, we have a big increase in the sale of personality profiles around Christmas time. As families gather together, one member of the family orchestrates the personality party aspect of the holiday. But what if that person whom you want to learn to understand, the one you need to get along with better, is resistant to taking a test? If you are in a difficult relationship with someone, it is awkward to go to that person and say, "I am having a tough time with you. Would you please take this profile so I can figure you out?" Or what about the people with whom you come in contact on a casual basis? The server at your favorite restaurant? The checker at the grocery store? Your child's teacher? Or the receptionist at your doctor's office? Can you figure them out without the benefit of the personality profile? Can you use the knowledge of the personalities to adjust your approach to those individuals and become their favorite person because of how you treat them? The answer is yes. You can learn to identify a person's basic and often secondary personality by learning to watch for the visible clues. Research shows that people will be more likely to respond favorably to you if they like you. So even those with whom you come in contact only occasionally are worth the little extra investment of time that it takes to understand their personality and to consequently adjust your approach to them. John Maxwell says, "Those who add to us draw us to them. Those who subtract cause us to withdraw." When you can identify the personality of others and then adjust your approach to them accordingly, you become a positive in their lives. The Patient from Hell. I have used this knowledge over and over in my life, and as a result, I have gained favor with people. Recently, I even found that my approach worked when I went to the dentist. I had moved from one side of town to the other, and I was looking for a new dentist who was nearer to my new location. When I asked around for a referral, a couple of my employees referred me to a man who had been their dentist for years. "You'll love it there," they told me. "It is an office full of sanguines." That piqued my interest, as my experience in the past with dentists was that they were usually perfect melancholies / peaceful phlegmatics. As a popular sanguine / powerful choleric, I always feel stupid around dentists because I do not floss enough. Who does? And I hate the out-of-control feeling I have while reclined in that chair, my mouth filled with hands and tools. But I liked the prospect of a sanguine dental office, so I called and made an appointment with Dr. Hearn. As I sat in the waiting area, my cell phone rang. I glanced around because most dental offices frown on people using cell phones while in the office. I was the only one in the waiting room, so I took the call. It was a return call from a friend who was trying to assist me with some computer problems. As we discussed the computer problem, Joanne, the receptionist at Dr. Hearn's office, chimed in, "I hate it when that happens," making it clear that she had been listening to my conversation. The tone of her voice did not indicate to me that she was irritated that I was on the phone in the office, but rather interested and involved in my conversation. I made some jovial comment back to her and continued my conversation until I was called for my appointment. On the way out, Joanne and I chatted about our mutual computer problems. We bonded. From just that brief interchange, I knew that Joanne was a popular sanguine. If a perfect melancholy had listened to my phone call, he or she never would have participated in a conversation on which he or she had been eavesdropping. If a perfect melancholy had been in charge of the front office, I would not have been on the phone in the first place, as there would have been signs posted about the prohibition of cell phone use. If I had not noticed the signs and answered my call anyway, I would have been scolded and told to turn off my phone. But in this particular office, the receptionist's cheerful involvement in my conversation told me that she was a popular sanguine, as my staff had predicted. Because I now knew she was a popular sanguine, we had an interchange that made us new best friends. When I had to go back for some additional treatment, I was late for my appointment. I miscalculated how long it would take to get there from my new house. On top of that, I could not remember which street the office was on or what the doctor's name was, so calling information wasn't an option. I called my office to see if anyone there could find this out for me, but the two staff members who went to this particular dentist were not in yet. Eventually, I got the information and made it to the dental office, albeit late. I told the receptionist my saga. She laughed appropriately and took me in without any reprimand. A month later, I was scheduled to return to have my permanent crown fitted. I never looked at my calendar, but the day before, I had overheard one of my staff members, Pam, take the call from the dentist office confirming my appointment. Pam had even put a post-it note on my purse with the reminder, which I never looked at. I was sure the appointment was at 4 p.m. The next morning, I was driving into town, heading into my office and yakking with my friend on the phone, when the call waiting sound beeped. I took the call. The receptionist, Joanne, was on the other end. She said, "We've run out of time to wait for you. We no longer have time to get your crown on." I gasped, "What do you mean? My appointment is at 4. After a brief chat, we figured out that my appointment had been scheduled for 8:40 a.m. When the call had been received in my office the previous day, I had heard Pam say 4:00. I planted that information in my brain as 4 p.m. when, in fact, she was actually confirming that the appointment was at 8:40 a.m. Fortunately, Joanne let bygones be bygones and offered me an appointment at 1:30 p.m. that afternoon, an appointment that I accepted and was subsequently late for. I had to call to verify the street and cross street, as I was sure I had passed it, and I had. I sound like the patient from hell, don't I? No sane dental office would want me as a patient. But Joanne and I had bonded. She welcomed me with no repercussions and no missed appointment charge. I got favor because she liked me. I had identified her personality and taken time to chat with her, during which time we connected. Wouldn't it be great if everyone with whom you interacted actually liked you? While you can't change those other people, you can figure out their personality and then change the way you approach them based on that information. But first, you must take the time to figure out what that personality is, just as I did with Joanne at the dentist's office. You do this by watching for the visual clues, people's clothing, mannerisms, and personal pace. Once you know what to watch for, you will be able to identify their personality almost as accurately as if you had them take a personality profile. Most adults have a lot of baggage when it comes to who they think they are, and these misconceptions can color the words they select on their profiles. They can be influenced by what their parents, their teachers, their bosses, and their spouses have wanted them to be, and they all probably verbalized different expectations. But when you are watching others, whether friends, co-workers, a spouse, from the outside, you begin to know them better than they know themselves. Often everyone else sees our traits, but we have difficulty owning who we are, especially our weaknesses. This is where knowing what to watch for is so helpful. In the remainder of this chapter, we will examine some of these visual clues as they relate to each of the personality types. Popular sanguine. Popular sanguines are first in the list, not because they are the most important, but because they are the most obvious to identify. In a crowd, these are the individuals who you see and hear. They are the ones about whom Chuck and I often look at each other and say, NTN, meaning no test needed. Their personality is so obvious that it just pops out of them. Rufus is one of those NTN people. He is a gate agent for an airline. Most gate agents simply take your ticket and look to see if your carry-ons meet the regulations. If they are having a good day, they may say, "Have a nice flight." But not Rufus. Even at a distance, you could tell that he was different. He was a splash of individuality in a uniform world. His black and white checkered glasses really made him stand out. I met Rufus while boarding a flight for a trip. As I approached the doorway, I noticed that he was cheerfully chatting with each customer as they passed by him. When it was my turn to board the plane, he reached out, gave me a hug, and said, "God bless you." Now, I had never seen Rufus before or since, yet he hugged me and blessed me. Yes, Rufus was an NTN popular sanguine, and he was in a job that was perfectly suited to his personality. While his bosses might have been frustrated with his chatty nature and wished that he'd get serious, I am sure his frequent flyers appreciate the cheer that he brings to the arduous task of flying. Not every popular sanguine will be as easy to identify as Rufus. But when you know what to look for, you can identify this personality type just as successfully. There are two key words that will help you spot the popular sanguines in a crowd: loud and open. Loud. Popular sanguines naturally have a loud voice that can be heard above the crowd. My personality is about 50% popular sanguine. When Chuck and I were dating, he was constantly shushing me when we were out in public. I find that nearly all popular sanguines have been shushed most of their lives. If we were in a restaurant and I was telling some entertaining story of what happened during my day, Chuck would encourage me to tone it down as others around us were listening. If I observed people at other tables straining to hear my story, I'd speak up so that they did not have to strain. I liked a bigger audience, the more the merrier. That might be part of the reason why we popular sanguines naturally have a loud voice. One of the greatest fears of the popular sanguine is that they might blend in, that they might not be noticed. They are naturally attracted to loud clothes, bright colors, and big prints, which may be why Rufus wore those checkered glasses. A popular sanguine woman may have big hair and wear dangly earrings or sparklies on her clothing. One day I was in a store looking longingly at a plaid and striped mixed print outfit, when two ladies came down the aisle and looked at the same outfit. One said to the other, "I just hate it when they do this. It looks so confused." She was definitely not a popular sanguine. A popular sanguine woman also likes theme dressing, selecting a different theme each day so as not to get into a rut and to keep others guessing. She may be equestrian one day, complete with riding boots, and a Mexican señorita the next, with an off-the-shoulder peasant blouse, a full skirt, and hoop earrings. Due to regional differences and professional requirements, not every popular sanguine will be dressed loudly. But when you see someone dressed this way, you can be pretty sure you have found a popular sanguine. My friend Gail lives in Pennsylvania, near Amish country. When she came to New Mexico with her husband for a business conference, she succumbed to the environment after about a week and bought a southwestern outfit with a broomstick skirt. She loved the outfit and wore it often while she was visiting. But when she wore it for the first time after she returned home, she told me that she felt foolish in it due to the conservative nature of the particular region in which she lived. Women have more fashion freedoms than men, so their clothing is more likely to identify them as having a popular sanguine personality. However, even a popular sanguine man will usually find a way to express some individuality when it comes to fashion, even when his profession, like Rufus's, requires a uniform. Let me give you an example. At a grocery store where I used to shop, there were two managers with whom I interacted. They were required to wear blue Oxford shirts, dark slacks, and ties. One manager looked very traditional in his pressed, long-sleeve shirt and regimental striped tie. His hair was perfectly combed and sprayed. The other manager had the same basic uniform, but he wore a short-sleeved Oxford shirt, frequently sported a novelty tie with a hula girl, complete with a grass skirt that wiggled when he moved, and combed his hair casually over his balding spot. He met the dress code, but still managed to express his personal individuality. Freedom to express oneself is important to a popular sanguine. Open. The other key thing to watch for in identifying the popular sanguine is that they are open. For one thing, the popular sanguine has an open mouth. They are uncomfortable with dead air and often feel compelled to fill the silence, a trait that has earned popular sanguines the moniker the talker. Due to my heavy travel schedule and rural residence, I do a lot of mail-order shopping. I flip through catalogs while I am on the plane and tear out the pages that interest me. When I get home, if I still think I need a particular item, I call and order it. I find that while I am placing the order with the person on the other end of the phone, there is often dead air while he or she keys in information or looks something up. So I fill that gap. I tell this complete stranger why I am buying this, whom it is for, whether it is late or on time, and so on. When Chuck hears me carrying on like this with people at the other end of the line, he says, "Marita, they don't care." So now I tell the salespeople, "You probably don't care, but I'm the type that is going to tell you anyway." Typically, they humor me and tell me that people like me make their job much more interesting. Phew! I am not the only one who does this. We popular sanguines save the customer service representatives from boredom. Not only do popular sanguines have an open mouth, but we also have an open life. Popular sanguines have no secrets, and if you have one, it is best not to tell a popular sanguine. This is not to say that we are malicious in sharing a confidence. Popular sanguines just have a very short distance from their brain to their mouth. What comes into their brain comes out their mouth with no processing in between. If you are talking to someone and he or she is telling you intimate personal details of his or her life, details that you have no business knowing, that person is probably a popular sanguine. It is for such folks that the term TMI, too much information, was created. One of Chuck's favorite nicknames for me is Miss Free Information. I have received this title due to my willingness to tell anyone anything at any time. For example, due to all the travel that I do for speaking engagements, I spend a lot of time on the phone with airline agents. Because I am usually dealing with the special frequent flyer service desk, they are especially nice. I often tell them, my husband's favorite nickname for me is Miss Free Information, but actually I am a motivational speaker and I get paid quite well for my information, so tonight you are getting a free seminar. They laugh appropriately and we banter throughout the remainder of the call. So the popular sanguine has an open mouth and an open life. They also have open body language. They are the huggy, kissy, touchy, feely ones. Popular sanguines will run toward you with open arms, as if they have not seen you in a year, even though you might have had lunch together last week. They are the ones who physically hold on to you while they are talking, usually because they are afraid you will leave before they finish the story. Cluttered. Another way that you can spot popular sanguines is by their cluttered personal space. Their home, office, or car will usually be littered with personal paraphernalia, pictures of the dog, the kids, the last vacation, name tags from various functions, a dead plant or two, and maybe a toy. The car of most popular sanguines is like a rolling diary of every fast food restaurant they have been to in the last week or two, with drink cups and crumpled up bags carelessly tossed into the back seat. Chuck, my perfect melancholy husband, often looks at my desk and says, "How do you work here? I get a headache just looking at this desk." But for those of us who are at least 50% popular sanguine, if it is out of sight, it is out of mind. We must keep everything that we are working on that has to get done out where we can see it every day. Popular sanguines are the ones who attend organization seminars. When I am speaking on this topic, I like to ask those in the audience who are popular sanguines why they go to these conferences, to which they shout back, "Because everyone tells us to." They know that they need to get their act together. But when they go home and do what the organization expert tells them to do, they end up not being able to find anything. When it was under the dead plant, they knew exactly where it was. But when they get it into a system, they are lost. Popular sanguines function best in their own litter, even though others with their best interests at heart are always trying to help them get their act together. So, let's review. The keys to identifying the popular sanguine are a loud voice and loud clothing, an open mouth, life and body language, and personal space that is littered with personal paraphernalia. If you find someone with most of those characteristics, you've found yourself a popular sanguine, NTN. Perfect melancholy. Perfect melancholies have the second most obvious personality trait, so let's look at the visible clues to identify this personality type. Take a look at the personalities chart in the bonus PDF. If you look at this chart, you will find that the popular sanguine is located diagonally across from the perfect melancholy. This is intentional, as the perfect melancholy and the popular sanguine are like polar opposites. In particular, where the popular sanguine is loud, open, and cluttered, the perfect melancholy is quiet, closed, and neat and tidy. Quiet. The perfect melancholy is quiet, and that quiet manifests itself most noticeably in a quiet voice. One of my best friends is a perfect melancholy. When I am on the phone with her, I can hear her clearly at the beginning of the conversation. But as we go on and she gets comfortable in the conversation, her voice drops. I find myself saying, "Huh? What did you say? I can't hear you." For those of us who are popular sanguines, our voices are naturally loud and we have to work to tone it down. The perfect melancholy is just the opposite. He or she has to work to project his or her voice. The perfect melancholy also likes quiet clothes. Chuck has 5 pairs of khaki pants and thinks he needs more because they are not all perfect anymore. He has proclaimed that all the best colors are found on a schnauzer. That would be gray, black, and white. Perfect melancholies like classic styles, traditional colors, and enduring value. One day while shopping with my perfect melancholy friend, I was admiring some cute, fun, hip, trendy outfit. As I was trying to determine if I could afford it or even needed it, she asked, "Why would you buy that? It's going to be out of style next year." To which I flippantly replied, "Darn, I hate it when that happens. I'll have to go shopping again next year." Perfect melancholies and popular sanguines see things from a totally different perspective, and they are wired completely different. I plan to go shopping next year and want to go shopping next year, while my friend prefers to make selections that will last. One time, my friend heard me recount this story when I was speaking at a seminar near her home. Afterward, she came up to me to defend her methods. "You know that green suit I have?" she asked. "Yes," I affirmed. She went on to explain that it was an expensive suit and that she had probably paid too much for it, but it was a really good fabric, and even after 6 years it was still like new. "And I am so sick of looking at it," I quipped. My friend hasn't worn it around me since. She is pleased that a suit she has been wearing for 6 years is still like new. I don't know why you'd want to wear the same thing for 6 years. Neither view is right or wrong. They are just different. Closed. As much as popular sanguines are open, perfect melancholies are just as much closed. They fully embrace the adage that silence is golden and keep their mouths closed. Recently, when Chuck and I watched the movie Ever After, a redo of the classic Cinderella story, a few lines in the film about the tone in which a lady of breeding should speak caught our attention. One of these was that a lady should not speak any louder than the gentle hum of a whispering wind. The other was that a lady should not speak unless they can improve the silence. Knowing the personalities, Chuck looked at me with a smile. "I like it," he said. To a perfect melancholy, not much could improve the silence. Chuck is a licensed professional clinical counselor. In the 23 years that we have been married, I have learned to differentiate between the time he comes home and reports on his day and the times that he is really hoping I will learn the lesson he had to teach his clients. Of course, as a perfect melancholy, he is very concerned about boundaries, and so I never know who these people are. One day, Chuck was telling me about a couple who was in his office. He was explaining that the combination of their personalities was very similar to our own. He said, "I was telling the wife that she needs to learn to play the silence." "Play the silence?" I asked. "Yes," he replied. "You sanguines," that was my clue that this was something I was supposed to learn, not just a report on his day, "need to learn to make a conscious choice to play the silence, like you play the radio. When you get into your car, you reach over and play the radio. You need to learn to make a choice to play the silence." My mental reaction to this teaching was to think to myself, "I am a big girl. I can do this." So now when we are in the car together and I have been quiet for a while, I say, "Have you noticed? I have been playing the silence." We laugh about it because we understand each other. In addition to having a closed mouth, the perfect melancholy also has a closed life. When Chuck and I met, he was in the military, which suited him very well because the armed forces operate on a need-to-know basis. Perfect melancholies will not tell you intimate details about their life, even if they are intimate with you. I have found that being married to a perfect melancholy and wanting to be included in his life is like being a junior talk show host. What did you do today? Then what happened? How did that make you feel? When you meet folks who are perfect melancholies, you will notice at once that they also have closed body language. They do not use flailing gestures. In fact, if they use gestures at all, they will be small, precise, and close to the body. I like to think of the perfect melancholy folks as the greatest respecters of space. They will stay out of your space, and they will expect you to stay out of theirs. Let me give you an example of how this works. Once when I was speaking in Freeport, Maine, I went to Friendly's, a favorite dining experience from my childhood. At the table next to me was a family that looked as if they could have come out of an L.L. Bean catalog. The mother and father were conservatively dressed in colors befitting to northern New Englanders. They had a baby in a high chair who was fairly well behaved. And then there was Owen. Owen was about 3, and he was all over the place. Now let's be clear, he wasn't behaving badly. He was just being a toddler. I was clear on his name because I heard, "Owen, stop that," several times during dinner. After Owen had eaten all that he wanted to eat, and his mother had eaten all that she was going to eat, Owen moved to her side of the table. He climbed up into her lap and then got down, then up. This obviously perfect melancholy mother had clearly had enough of Owen. She stood him in front of her, looked into his perky little eyes, and said, "The lesson for today is personal space. I have my personal space, and you have your personal space. This is my personal space." She swept her hands.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.